The second candle of Advent is the candle of peace. As we light this special candle, remember that peace is possible. God promises that a day is coming when the wolf and the lamb will live together, and the lion and the calf will not be enemies. On that glorious day, Jesus will come to lead us as the gentle shepherd and the Prince of Peace.
Would you join me in our call to worship? We are all welcome to this place, just as you are. Whatever hopes or worries are on your mind, you are welcome. Prepare the way of the Lord. Make the path straight. Young or old, tall or small, we are all part of God's vision.
Prepare the way of the Lord. Make the path straight.
Let us welcome one another just as Christ has welcomed us.
Prepare the way of the Lord. Make the path straight.
Thank you. As we stand before God, would you please join me in our unison prayer? Comfort us, O God, with a comfort that strengthens us for the world. Comfort us, O God, with a comfort that encourages us to trust you. Comfort us, O God, with a comfort that inspires us to be messengers of hope, that our world may be transformed, and that it may begin here, in this place, and among these people. Comfort us, O God, with a comfort that renews your living and our worship. Amen. Peace and love of God be with you.
And also with you.
Please leave your pew and welcome somebody. Go ahead. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I want to say it real loud. Ready? Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah. All the adults love to hear you say good morning. It's kind of fun to have kids here in a church with us. You know that, don't you? We talk about worship. What does worship mean to you?
Yes.
Well, that's kind of right. Yeah. Anybody else want to say something about worship? Yeah, what? Worship. When we come to worship, we come to worship God, and we come to worship God because we want to obey God. That's one thing. And we want to say to God, you've done wonderful, wonderful things, and you're really, really, really cool. Yes. Yeah, they worship things, and they worship other kinds of gods. And we call those other kinds of gods, gods with a little g, like when you spell G-O-D. And our God is the God with the big G, capital G. Yeah, that's the difference. That's who our God is. Ours is the one that's got the capital G. And we worship the God who has the capital G, because that God is the one that made everything, and he really is the only God. God is really the only God, the capital G God. That's our God. God made the world, God made the universe, God made you, God made me, and all of us are different. Every one of us is different. You know, our faces are different, our eyes are different, Sometimes our thoughts, our feelings are different. You know, the fact is, we worship God because God has been good to all of us. And God has shared with us an awful lot of things, very important things in our life. You know, God made the ability to have food. Who wants to do without food? Raise your hand. Anybody want to do without food? You do? Holy mackerel. I bet you like food. You like food, don't you? Yeah, you like food. I like food, too. You like potato chips, something like that? Do you like potato chips? He's not sure. Okay. All right. See, I stay away from potato chips because that's not good for me. But food, there's lots of food to eat. And God made water. You know, if we didn't have water, we wouldn't have water to drink. It'd be tough for us to take a bath. Of course, some people don't like to take baths, but sometimes you do have to take a bath. And water is just a very, very important thing, isn't it? God made trees. God made everything. And so here we are, and we're the children of God. You and I are the children of God. So we come to church and we worship God. But more importantly, we worship here, and that's important. But what's important is that we worship God with our lives every day, by the way we act, by the way we treat other people, by the way we talk. That's worship too. You know, when you act like a good, nice person and like a person who loves others, you know what that says to other people? That says you're one of God's people. You know, and to be one of God's children, one of God's people, that's a very important role to play in life. So, what I'm saying to you is we worship because God is good, and God is so great, and God is worthy of our worship and praise. And worship helps us together to grow stronger in our faith. So when you're here, you learn more and more about Jesus, you learn more about God, you learn more and more about the church, and it makes you stronger and stronger. It makes you better and better as a person. And as you grow up, you'll have a lot of good stuff to carry with you in your brain and your heart and your soul because you come to church and you worship. So will your parents and so will your grandma and grandpa because they're out there worshiping, and we sing our hymns and we say our prayers, and we say those because, remember, God is awesome. God is worthy of worship. And that's why we come here. That's why we're here. Worshiping God and praising God. Got it? Yeah. Good. Let's pray. Yeah, go ahead.
People used to worship the Roman Empire.
Yeah, people worship the Roman Empire. Some people worship their, you know, when they worship their country over their God, that's not the thing to do. When they worship things over God, that's not the thing to do. God is the only thing we should worship. Thing, person, actually, that we should worship. When we worship other things, then we're told not to worship other things. We're told we should worship just God. Just God. That's a good point. Let's pray. God, we thank you very much for our children. We thank you for their wisdom. We thank you for their intelligence and their abilities and how they bless this church. We bless you for them, and we pray, God, your blessing on each one of them, that they might grow strong, healthy, well, and serve you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you for coming up.
Yeah.
It is such a blessing to have a church with so much talent and capability, and to serve a congregation that has that in it, serving the Lord in that way. It's great. I'm going to read to you from John chapter 4, verses 1 through 26. And what this is, you'll recognize, is Jesus talking to the woman at the well. And it's not about the fact that he's talking to her at the well this time, I'm reading to you, because it's about what Jesus says about worship to her that I want you to hear when we get to the end of the story. Now, when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did not baptize, but only his disciples, he left Judea and departed again for Galilee, and he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. So Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." And Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that he is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." A woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." And Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." And the woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water." Well, Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come here." And the woman answered him, said, "I have no husband." And Jesus said to her, "You're right in saying I have no husband, for you have five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. So what you have said is true." And the woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called the Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things." Then Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." May God add the blessing to the reading and the hearing of this God's holy word. Amen. In our adult Sunday school class, they've been following along the same path that the sermons are going throughout Advent. And so I hope that what I have to share with you will help those of you who are studying in that class, and also will help the rest of you in living of your life and in your journey throughout this Advent season to Christmas. Over the last 2,000 years, it has been stated by more than just a few that the purpose of the church is to worship and praise God. That is the purpose of the church, to worship and to praise God. To worship God is to ascribe honor and glory along with a tinge of awe to our Creator. There are many potential objects, beings, and persons to which and to whom people have ascribed glory and honor. And in the truest sense of the word, those things and those people are worshiped. For instance, many people in our culture are fixated on acquiring wealth. That's what a lot of folks are trying to do. And for those who maintain that as the primary goal in their lives, money then has become to them what they worship, as if it were a god, little g. But it becomes for them a god, big G. The one who has created us, however, is truly the only one deserving of our worship, truly the only one deserving of our praise, the only one deserving of our adoration. When Jesus had a discussion with the Samaritan woman at Jacob's well, as you just now heard, our Lord told the woman, "The hour is coming. The hour is coming, and now is near, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship Him." God is spirit, Jesus said, and those who worship Him must worship in spirit and truth. Jesus was making the point to the woman that the worship of any person or anything other than the one true God would simply be misdirected and wasted time. Only God can satisfy, because we were made by God and we were made for God. In the story of Jesus' birth, we can see modeled for us how worship played a principal role in the birth story itself, and done so in a variety of ways. The three wise men followed a star. They left their home country. They came out of Iraq, Persia. They came out of their home country to follow the star and come hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of miles away from their home to be where this star took them, in a foreign land. And then to worship the Christ child, they gave gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And such things were only the very wealthy could have. Those would be things that Jesus' mom and dad could use to raise him and help him out. Then there were the shepherds who came to worship on the night of Jesus' birth, because the heavenly host had appeared to them and told them to go to Bethlehem. So they did, and they gathered around the manger. They bring the gift of their company, the gift of celebration, to the little family sitting there in the cave as the shepherds worshiped and praised God for the privilege of what they saw. And it said as they walked away from that picture, they walked away, they were talking about how wonderful it was, and they were praising God and they were thanking God and worshiping God for that opportunity to be there that night and see that child. Then, of course, let's not forget Mary and responding to God's call to be the one who would carry the child in her womb, a way of worshiping the Creator by doing something for the Creator extraordinary, beyond the norm. Carrying the baby Jesus, worshiping and glorifying God. And of course, on that same night, so long ago, though the purest worship was witnessed in the choir of angels. The choir of angels praising God from out of the heavens and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom He is pleased." A stunning display of glory, causing the shepherds to believe the baby Jesus was indeed sent by God. So God truly deserves our praise. God truly deserves our adoration. So how can we worship God? How is it that we can worship God with praise and adoration? Well, author Max Lucado has outlined three ways to worship God. The first way, he notes, is to worship God verbally. In Matthew 12:34, it is recorded that Jesus taught, "Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks." You know, what you have in your heart is really what you say, what you think, meaning what your emotional person feels, your spiritual person feels. That's what really is there. And what they're saying, what Jesus is saying, is out of your heart, you know, is what your mouth says. When you speak verbally, you speak about God. You speak about praise for God, for what God has done for you, how God has blessed you. I have the privilege of making a living doing that. verbally praising God with hopefully all my teaching. But the fact is that we are people who can praise God with out of our own mouths. God is so gracious to us, and God's blessings are so abundant that our hearts should be overflowing with so much thanksgiving, we can't help but say how wonderful God has been to us. You know, in my own life, I realize, you know, I look back over my life, and I realize, you know, I have been so blessed. Yes, there have been many difficulties. Yes, there have been many problems. Yes, there have been many times I've messed up. No one in this room is perfect, and I'm least among them. But the fact is that God has taken care of every need I've ever had. God has been there for me, got me through whatever it is I had to face. And God will do that for you too. That's the thing we need to know. We need to be able to say that. Because you know that. You know in your life how God has touched you, how God has helped you, how God has gotten you through situations, how God has blessed you with abundance, how God has helped you through many circumstances. You may never have said it, but just say it. We can worship God verbally. God is so gracious to us. God's blessings are so abundant that our hearts should be overflowing with thanksgiving. And we need, with the words of our mouths, we need to tell God how thankful we are. We need to verbally worship God and say, thank you. Thank you for all that you've done for us. The second way that Lucado says we can worship God is in community. Now, the writer of the book of Hebrews made it clear that coming together to worship God is an imperative for Christians. It's an imperative. You know, I don't understand people who say that they don't need to come to church or they don't need to worship God. Yeah, you can go out into a field. Yes, you can think about how wonderful God is. You can look at that tree and say, oh, God created that tree. Isn't that a wonderful thing? You can look at the sky and see the sky is so blue and you can say, isn't that a wonderful sky? Isn't that all wonderful? But you don't really worship in that sense. Where worship happens is in community, truly, because when people come together, and we come together as a body in Christ, and we come together aware that we're folk that have the same kind of ideas, we're folk that want to reach out to the same God, we want to talk about Christ, we want to live this life, and we want to do better than what we've been able to do. It's coming together and giving strength to one another in the faith that's important. It's an imperative that we do that. That's what church is about. The church is the people. Remember the old thing? Here's the church, here's the steeple, open the door, and there's the people. Well, the church is the people. We can be the church outside this building. We can worship in a parking lot. We can worship in a gymnasium. We can worship in somebody's living room. But we come here to be the church. To be the church and to find strength in one another's encouragement. Find strength in the fact that there are people in town who all think about the same God, who all are concerned about the same life that the rest, that I am concerned about it, that you're concerned about. And so it's imperative that we come together encouraging one another. Hebrews 10:24 said, and let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another. The Christian faith must be practiced in community for it to be real faith. For early Christians, gathering was against the law. The early Christians, the first 300 or so years, they worshiped in the sewers of Rome. They worshiped in places that none of you would ever or I would ever want to go. And they had to do that because you could be executed for being a Christian. Now, you know, you'd think, you know, something like that going on, you'd probably, that kind of religion would have died. You know, people don't want to be executed, but you know, Christians were put, they were fed to the lions in the Colosseum, they were hung on crosses on the Appian Way, they lit the Appian Way, the roadway at night with the burning bodies of, on crosses of Christians. That's how Christians lived in those days. And it was important enough for them to come together and to worship, then it should be important enough for us to come together and worship. We should be in church and we should be together worshiping as the people of God. There are people who died in the beginning of this faith that the faith might live and come down to us. They gave their lives being Christians. Just that was their only crime. They were Christians. They lived under such a government oppression. We must worship God in community. It's an imperative. The third way to worship God that Lucado wrote is to worship God demonstrably. Now, the psalmist expresses this in Psalm 63. He wrote, saying, because he was speaking to God, because your steadfast love is better than life. God, because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live. In your name, I will lift up my hands. Worshiping God is not simply a tradition to which we adhere because we feel duty-bound. You know, I know in the past there have been people that show up for church because they felt like, well, this is what the family does, and this is what you're supposed to do, and this is what it looks good in the community. I know today the only reason you're in church is because you want to be. In this world that we live in, the things that are going on out there, all the choices that you have, you want to be in church. You wouldn't be here. That's what's going on in our society. The ones that want to be in church and want to be close to God are sitting in the pews. That's who really we are. The ones in the pews are the ones who want to be here. And so worship is very important from that standpoint. But, you know, it's a demonstration of whom we are, what we are about. We need to walk our lives step by step through the doors that God opens and worship God with our lives and our actions and the things that we say. We come here, we stand and we sit, we sing songs and we pray, we bow our heads, we demonstrate our faith in God by coming here and doing the things that are traditional, but also by coming here and realizing this is where we want to be. And we demonstrate that by our physical presence. And that's what God calls us to do. So we are to worship God verbally, we are to worship God in community, and we must worship God as even a demonstration, demonstrably. Worship works wonders. When you go home from here, you should go home feeling like you've been someplace special. When you go home from here, you should go home thinking about what's been said, what's been thought of, what the music was saying to you, how the bells spoke to you, how the organist, what she played, speaks to you, how the children's voices, what the children's voices said for you, you know, the hope that that gave you when you heard those little voices up here talking wise things. Their little minds thinking about things that we forget about. And hopefully you go away from here having heard what's spoken from this pulpit and realizing that it has some impact on your life in some way, shape, or form, that you need to really pay attention to it. Worship works wonders when you do it. It works wonders when you allow it to work in your life. Worship can become more than just being here too. As you go out that door, your life can become a worship. And the way you live, the way you think, the way you talk, the way you treat people, and the way you love others is you should love God and you love yourself. Worship happens out in the streets and in the fields, in the factories and the schools too, in the way you live. You carry it with you. That was Mahatma Gandhi. And Mahatma Gandhi, you know, wasn't a Christian at all. Mahatma Gandhi was a Hindu, if it was any religion. He lived in a hut, and in his hut he had a picture of somebody's rendering of what Jesus might have looked like, hanging in his hut. Mahatma Gandhi was a rich man, but he chose to live in simplicity. And Mahatma Gandhi was once stating what the seven deadly sins are, and he said one of them is worship without sacrifice. One of the seven deadly sins, he said, is worship without sacrifice. The sacrifice Christians are to bring to our worship is different than the sacrifice of the Christians in the first 300 years. Those Christians sacrificed their lives, their homes. They risked it all for God. Today, the sacrifice that we're asked to bring is the willingness to praise God. The willingness to praise our God with all our heart, with all our mind, with all our soul. Just as the coming of the Christ child into the world was celebrated by the wise men, by Mary, the shepherds, even the angels in worshipful ways, so too should our worship of God be a sacrifice. Our worship of God should be a sacrifice holy and acceptable unto the Lord and full of wonder and praise. Just think, isn't it wondrous that the great God of all the universe is mindful of you? that the great God of the universe knows you by name. And you are sitting in one of his houses, worshiping God. And that you belong to God. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wondrous? That's the sacrifice that we should bring. Our joy, our hope, our peace, as we worship God with our words, as we worship God together in community, as we worship God in our actions. Amen. Will you pray with me? Oh God, we are so privileged to worship you. We know that worship is not really about making you feel good. What worship is really about is helping us understand to whom it is we belong, and that's you. You are deserving of all honor and praise and glory. It is you, God, who has called the universe into being, given us life, and helped us to understand what hope is. And now we praise you for that, and we honor you for that. Lead us each one in our lives, we pray. Forgive us of our sins, either those committed or those things that we should have done that we didn't do. We pray, and we ask you. As we pray, we remember that there are those around us who need our love and our concern. We know that there are people who are watching television today, watching this service on TV, and who know that they can't make it here because their bodies are sick or holding them back. But they're worshiping with us as much as we are worshiping here. And our hands and our eyes and our hopes reach out to them, blessing them, wanting them to be well. We ask, God, that you'd be with us here in this church as we continue to try to do your work in the best way we know how. You've blessed us in so many ways. You've encouraged us in so many ways. And this congregation continues to move forward because it is a pathway that you have chosen for this group of people to follow. Lord, as we pray, we ask for blessings on those who serve us as police officers. There seems to be a real concern today for those who take part in that work. We ask that you'd watch over them, protect them, guide them, help them to make right decisions, help them to be people who are safer and respected. We ask, God, that you be with those who protect us when there is disaster or fire, like the tornadoes that they've suffered in the south or the fires that they've suffered in Tennessee and out west. There are people who go and risk their lives for us, people who come to our houses and take us to hospitals, and people who come to our houses and fight the fires that save our valuables. Bless them. Be with them. And all of those who are in our military, wear a military uniform, wherever they are. We are the only country in the world, God, and you know this, that has military in 164 nations in the world. We are the American Empire. And because we are, we have a road to trod, which we better be serious about. And that is to be a loving, caring nation and known to be such. Help us, though we are strong in military, though we are mighty, help us to understand that it's love that really conquers all and love that really makes a difference that we should share around this planet. Oh God, bless those who serve us in those uniforms. Bless them, I ask, who serve us in those uniforms. Watch over them, protect them. Now I know that each person in this room, God, has something going on inside them, whether it's praise, whether it's thanksgiving, whether it's pain, whether it's sorrow. Would you be with us in a moment of silence? Examine our hearts. Help us to feel the presence of your Spirit and to understand. Thank you, God, for being close to us, being near to everyone in this room. May our lives bless you. May our works give praise to you. May we, by what we say and do, honor your name. In the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You know that God has blessed you. You can't help but know that. But what you do with what you give in your time and talent and treasures is you bless God back. And God deserves that. So through the worship of your giving, have the feeling and awareness that you are one who is doing the will of God and blessing our Creator. Give cheerfully.
Thank you.
Eternal God, we bring these things before you as a symbol of our belief that what you want to have happen in this world is what needs to happen. And what that is to love one another and to love you and to be a people at peace with hope and joy all around us. And so now, God, we bless you for the ability to give of our time, our talent, our treasures. We bless you for all that you have done for us, and we thank you. And with that gratitude in our hearts, we praise you in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us that we, your people, would be the best people in the world if we work hard at it and love you. Amen. There's a world waiting to hear it said. Go tell it on the mountain. Shout it. Say it. Believe it. Live it. Go be the people of God out in a world that is crying for his love, crying for joy, crying for peace, crying for hope. Go be the people who carry that message in your lives and help others be kind and compassionate, faithful, faith-filled people, and God will be faithful to you. God's face then will shine on you, and God will grant you peace. Amen.